Welcome to Modern Mindset, the show that picks the brains of the world's leading minds to help you unlock yours. Decoding the beliefs and strategies of global experts to give you an updated mindset to make the most of modern life. Hosted by the UK's most in-demand and highest paid hypnotherapist, Adam Cox.
This is Modern Mindset, the show that picks the brains of the world's leading minds to help you unlock yours. I'm your host, Adam Cox, and joining me today, we have journaling expert and coach, Alex Badita. Welcome to the show.
Hi, Adam. Thank you so much for having me.
Great to have you on the show. And it must be about, 3 years ago since you were on the show last time, you wrote a book all about the importance of writing. And since then, you've kind of honed in on this kind of topic of journaling. Where did that evolution come from? Why is that such an important topic for you?
I think it was the power of how journaling can change people's lives. And I wanted to dive deeper because I could see the results whenever I would work with people. And even when we were doing coaching sessions from one session to another, having journaling exercises was really where they got their breakthrough. So I really focused on understanding better what is behind journaling, writing. I went deeper into the neuroscience to really understand what our brain does when we start writing and putting pen to paper. And also to see the differences between personal journaling, business journaling, how we can use it, how we can see results, and most importantly, how to be consistent with it.
Consistency is the key, isn't it? Because I think everyone has done some elements of diary entries, journaling, at least once or twice in their life. It might be school homework. What did you do over the summer holidays? You know, it might be when something really stressful or impactful is happening in people's lives. Why do you think there is a reluctance or a barrier to people being consistent with journaling?
It's a vicious circle because people don't see results and they expect that they write something in their journal and they get the magical solution to a problem. But it takes time, and that requires for them to write every day for a period of time. And after that, they will start to see shifts and transformation. But if they don't see the results straight away, they give up. So they will never see results if they give up. And in order for them to see that, they need to keep going. So this, you know, you have to find where you can break that circle. And of course, it has to begin with small steps. You know, it doesn't mean that you have to give, 1 hour a day to journaling, because I think that many people feel that, well, I don't have time for this. This is something so difficult and it requires so much time. But the truth is that just 5 minutes of journaling can make such a huge difference. And there are so many studies, there are so many methods out there that say how implementing the 5 minutes journal and, you know, just writing your gratitude, setting your intention, and then reflecting, these are the three main components that you can do. And if you're consistent with those, then you will start seeing results. But yes, it's something that you need to do, you know, and I say this to people as well, is like when going to the gym, you cannot go once and expect to walk out the door thinner and with more muscles. You know, it takes time for that to develop. And it's the same with any kind of habit, including journaling.
Yeah. And I'm so glad you said those three components, because I've never actually took a course on journaling, but I think intuitively, those are the three things that I tend to find myself doing when I get thoughts out of my head onto, I don't write them physically, I use an app, but setting intentions, I think, is such a powerful thing. So it doesn't have to be, you know, big, you know, amazing goals, but just what do you want to have happen, I think is such an important thing. And I tend to do it, I don't know if this is the right thing to do, but just from what I've learned about goal setting, is state it as if I've already achieved it, if that makes sense. So rather than saying, you know, I want to lift this amount of weights, it's I can lift, or I'm lifting this amount of weights. And I find that really useful. Gratitude gets me in a better state, you know, just saying, you know, this was the highlight of my day, or this is something that's really important. But where I find it most useful, and that's just habitual for me, is when I'm going through some kind of challenge or big decision. So that element of before you make the decision, getting thoughts out of your head in a way that you can be a bit more objective about it, suddenly takes a lot of the emotion away. From your perspective, where did your journaling journey start? You know, how young were you when you started to regularly get thoughts out of your head onto paper or diary or something?
I'm really glad that you said diary, because I want to mention that there is a difference between diary and journal. Because when we start, you know, in high school or school, we write in a diary. We just write down the activities that we did throughout the day. And it's just a way to, you know, kind of get out of our own head. And sometimes, you know, as teenagers, we write how annoyed we are about the world around us, or, you know, when everything is such a big drama. But journaling in itself is a very different tool, in the sense that we get more into the emotions behind the activities. We start to dig deeper. We have a different intention, and the results are also different. So for me, I would say that I started my first diary when I was 8 years old, but journaling in itself became more consistent later in life, when I realized that it has this powerful benefit of really helping me to understand myself better and to see things more clearly. And for me, just asking myself questions and being able to monitor my thoughts and my emotions, that was the biggest change, because I could understand, well, the thoughts that I'm thinking are giving me the emotions that I'm feeling, and my emotions impact the way that I am taking action. So that was the biggest moment when I realized, well, actually, there's more to writing. So I want to make sure that I do it first for myself in a very powerful way, and then I can share it with other people so that they also see results. But I think the best way is to see these results from the perspective of how deep you can go inside of yourself to get to know yourself better. And like you said, you know, to get all of those thoughts, which sometimes are not even yours. There are things that you may have heard from other people. There are so many other conditions or, you know, preconceptions and different mentalities, and release those on paper. And then actually you get to the layer behind, where that's where you are. That's where your beliefs are. And that's where you can take a good decision from.
Mm. I think that element of distinction between diary and journal, for a lot of people, I think a diary is what they plan to do, and a journal is kind of reflecting on what they've done. But I think where that confusion comes from is probably the most famous journal, the Diary of Anne Frank, which wasn't a diary at all. It was a journal. It was her reflecting on traumatic events and getting the thoughts of a 13-year-old onto paper. So yeah, absolutely, there is a distinction there. But I don't think Anne Frank helped on that specific area. Maybe she didn't call it a diary. Maybe it's just what other people called it. In terms of the element of reflection, the thing I find fascinating about journals is to look back on ones that I've done months ago, years ago, because in a way it's almost the verbal, the written equivalent of a photograph, you know. And sometimes, you know, when you see people, you mentioned going to the gym, the before and after photo, you can only really notice the transformation when there is time in between. And I find that with journaling as well, sometimes that you don't realize how much progress you've made until you see the emotions linked to feeling really anxious or really stressed, and you're like, oh, I don't feel that anymore. But you need time in between. And I think that's probably why consistency is such an important element, because otherwise you can't see the trends, you can't see the changes, the patterns, because you're always in yourself at the point where you have these thoughts. Where do people get it wrong? You know, what are the mistakes, the pitfalls that tend to happen when people start a journal?
I think, you know, it starts even with the smallest things that sometimes maybe we don't take into consideration, like the notebook that you choose to write in. If it's not a notebook that you like and is just I don't know, something that you maybe have been writing something else in, and then you say, well, I still have like 10 pages in it and I will use it as my journal, then you will not feel so compelled to write in it. Then there's also the experience that you have, the experience that you create. You know, if you feel that you are being disturbed all the time, or you can't really sit down with your thoughts, or, you know, there is a lot going on and I don't know, you can't find a specific moment in your day to actually do that, then that experience is not going to be pleasant. It's going to feel like a burden, and it's not going to make you feel like I want to go back to writing again. So I think it's important to create the experience in such a way that even for those 5 minutes, you literally just are by yourself with your journal. You really enjoy the writing tools that you have. Maybe even, I don't know, use some peaceful music in the background. Maybe light a candle or use some essential oils, something that enhances all your senses so that you are super present. It's an act of mindfulness in itself when you start writing. So you want to be there present for those 5 minutes, and then it will completely change your day. And of course, if you feel that that is not happening for you, then it will be more difficult to keep that consistency. So I think that's a few things that are really, really simple that can really change the way that we see journaling.
Mm. Yeah, it's the anchors, isn't it? The emotional associations with the tools. That could be the chair you sit in, the environment, you know. And when I first started journaling, I had this really expensive fountain pen and this like leather bound book, and it was, it's quite exciting. Actually, these days, I use an app on my phone, because what I like about it is that because it automatically saves it in the cloud, like whatever device I'm using, I know it's going to be there, if that makes sense. And I think it's the convenience. But to begin with, in those first few bits, it felt exciting for me. And for me at that time, my late teenage years, I was going through severe social anxiety. I was going through feelings of overwhelm and stress and all this kind of stuff. So I used it for getting thoughts out of my head, but also to almost be my own therapist, which sounds weird, but kind of thinking of a very specific problem. What was I doing to create this problem? And what changes could I do that would have a ripple effect? And I think if I just did it in my head, it wouldn't have worked the same. But by getting it onto a piece of paper, I could then see what I was doing as if I was someone else. And that's maybe one of the reasons that I'm a therapist now, is because I was able to kind of practice on myself in a way that I could see the progress, if that makes sense. What would you say is the big benefit? You mentioned one of the things that stop people being consistent is they don't see results. What, if you were narrowing it down into the top two or three benefits that people tend to get from journaling, what would you say they are?
First of all, it's clarity. You get clear on, let's say, goals, if you set goals, right? You get clear on the things that you have going on in your life. You know, most of the people who I speak with before they start journaling, they just run their life without being very aware of what is going on. They have a set schedule and they know what is their routine, and the way that it starts, the way that it ends, and then they start all over again the next day. Starting to be aware about some of your habits, some of your good habits, your bad habits, gives you clarity on what you want to keep in your life and what you don't want to keep. And it gives you clarity on the direction that you want to take moving forward. And also setting those goals for yourself means that you will know exactly what are the steps that you're going to take. And science says that when you write your goals down, you have 42% more chances to actually achieve those goals, because you already made that commitment and you are more accountable. And you can also create a plan of action. Another benefit would be having more peace of mind, because you are releasing those negative emotions. You are really making your mind calmer, in a sense, because, you know, especially anxiety, when it comes with a rush of emotions, a rush of thoughts, when you put your head down and you know, to go to sleep, but you can't really sleep because your mind starts to bring all of those things and you are literally overwhelmed. Your heart starts beating, maybe you start sweating, you're really in a very uncomfortable place, but it's difficult to actually go and start to put them down. However, it's the way to go, because when you release them on paper, you make room. Like you release that, you get to a more peaceful state and you kind of let go of that burden, you know, because if you're keeping it just yourself and you're carrying around, you know, it's going to be there. And we are living in our mind all the time. It's not like we can move to another country and leave our mind somewhere else. No, we're going to carry that with us. So we have to be our friends. We have to make friends with our mind and with our thoughts. So in that way, it's our job to create that peace of mind. And through writing, we can do that. And I would also add another really big benefit, which is for our immune system. And again, there are a lot of studies that show how our immune system benefits from writing things down and unloading all of this on paper, because our stressful emotions and all of that negative tension gets stored in our body. And when we start to release that onto paper, those immune, the cells for immunity are not concerned to see, well, where is this stress going on? Like what's happening? They are actually doing their job to keep you safe and healthy. So we are helping our immune system to do its job and to keep us healthy in a way, rather than getting our cells preoccupied to figure out where is this stress coming from. And there are so many people who get sick because they embody all of those emotions. And, you know, there is a big link between sickness and our thoughts and our emotions. So again, there is science behind it, but just knowing that we have such a powerful tool and very simple at the same time, you know, we can take care of our own health and we can be responsible and take our own life in control. So yeah, this would be the three main benefits to sum up. It would be clarity, it would be peace of mind, and healthy immune system.
It's fascinating as you're saying that, because it all makes sense. You know, the average, well, conscious mind can pay attention to about 7 thoughts, you know, plus or minus 2. So if you keep them in here rather than get them out on paper, they're going to keep coming up again. And there was a period in my life where I couldn't sleep because I would be thinking about things in completely the wrong context. Get them out of your head, you know, see them more objectively. And then that feeling of overwhelm immediately feels a bit more manageable, because you can see your situation a bit more objectively and then figure out what to do. And I also think that when people are in that overwhelmed, stressful state, there's a biochemical reaction to that. You've got more cortisol, you've got more adrenaline, and these kind of things, for a lot of people, they don't make them feel good. So it's not just that it affects their kind of, you know, biochemical, you know, kind of overall health and immunity, but the average person will self-medicate with drink, drugs, or food to deal with those emotions, and then that has health, you know, consequences. So it seems such a powerful thing that has so many benefits. Why don't more people do it?
I mean, it can be as easy as we make it or as difficult as we make it. And the truth is that asking the right questions is the most difficult part, because when we are by ourselves, you know, we can open our journal and start writing, but we will only go so far until it gets uncomfortable. And if we're not willing to go deeper, then we will just shut down the notebook and go on with our day. If we have to answer to some guided questions and we are willing to actually dig and unpeel that layer, then we will start to see the result. But yes, it is uncomfortable. And very, very many times the answer will not come up in the first round of journaling. So this is why, again, consistency is the main key, because even when you journal about one specific topic, like for instance, if you're trying to figure out an emotion that is coming up very frequently around success or around failure in your business, then you may not understand it from the beginning. You will keep asking different questions. You will have to journal around different situations from your past until you get that breakthrough. So it is uncomfortable. This is why sometimes having the support of guided exercises will make a difference, but it's really powerful.
I think at some level, it's you're kind of telling your unconscious mind, this is important. This is an important thing because I'm choosing to write about this rather than all the other things that I can write about. And what I found is that sometimes just by doing that, you get ideas like 2 or 3 days later, just out of nowhere, because your unconscious is thinking, yeah, there's that problem and we haven't figured out a solution yet. So I think, you know, sometimes people have this expectation that if they ask a question, they need an answer straight away, or if they've got a problem, they have to solve it straight away. And actually, that's not how the mind works sometimes. Sometimes it likes to kind of solve it in the background and then, you know, give you the solution when you least expect it. What's been the most surprising or beneficial thing that you've got from journaling in your life?
For me, the biggest one is when I do reflection, because as I like to say, growth happens in the moments of reflection, because when we actually start to look at different patterns that we have and different things that we repeat throughout the years without even realizing, that is when we start to be able to make some shifts. And for me, because I have been doing a lot of inner work and I have been digging quite deep with a lot of things in my life, relationships and business and my relationship with money and the way that I see success, failure, being consistent with everything that I do and being motivated, all of these things are really, really powerful whenever I sit down and write in my journal. And I think also one of the biggest ones is to when I wrote down my vision and the reason why I'm doing what I'm doing, the reason why I chose to do and share this work around journaling and this powerful tool. And every time when there is something that's not working or it's not working according to my expectations, I go back to that journal entry and I read it and I read why I started and I read about the motivation that I have, and it instantly brings me back up. And I think that's a really good exercise for any entrepreneur, for anyone in business. Just have this as a regular practice, and you can revisit that again every month or every 6 months, or read it whenever you need it. Write down the motivation and the vision that you have, because this is what's going to bring you back whenever it feels that it's too much, or you're feeling overwhelmed, or something is not going the way that you were thinking it would. And I think for me, that was a really major breakthrough, especially in those moments of burnout, or when you feel like everything is falling apart. Like, what can you do? Just having that and writing that and revisiting that is really, really the best way to cope with it.
You're fluent in two languages, possibly more, I don't know, but definitely two. When you do journaling, do you think in English or Romanian? Like, what's your language that you write in?
It's very funny because I write in English and I feel much more comfortable to write in English. And this actually started from high school, I think. Well, even in school, I was writing in Spanish and English as well, because I wanted to make sure that in case my parents find my journal, they will not be able to understand what I'm writing. But now it just feels a lot more natural. Somehow I find my vocabulary faster to write in English. And it's really funny when I have conversations with my therapist and, you know, we talk in Romanian and we talk about these concepts. And then I start sharing with her what I wrote in my journal. And it's like, well, you know, in my journal, it sounds like this. But luckily she understands really well. So yeah, it's good. But yeah, it's in English, because most of the content that I create is in English. However, now being based in Romania already for 3 years, I started to do more work here in Romanian as well, because I feel that there is a lot to do and a lot of growth and education to be done here as well.
We mentioned Anne Frank as you're probably the most famous journal of all time. Do you think it's important that children learn this process of journaling?
Absolutely. The sooner, the better. And the best way to actually start doing that, I think, is from parents, seeing parents that journal at home, and maybe they explain a little bit why they're doing that, because children tend to model their parents' behavior. So creating maybe a ritual together, and then obviously in schools and having teachers who encourage children to keep a journal. And last year I started a pilot program with a teacher here in Romania, where we were talking about journaling with children who were 12, 13 years old. And we encouraged them to keep a journal, and we gave them exercises. And that was how we understood their needs and what exactly they feel is most appropriate and most useful for them to write and in a journal. So this year we started the project Journaling in Schools, which is taking a lot of awareness here in Romania, and we're also expanding it internationally, because we want children from early ages, 8, 9, 10 years old, to have this practice of writing in a journal, to become aware of their thoughts and emotions and their individuality, because this is something that, at least in the Romanian education system, is lacking and is missing. So we want them to have this. And also because it enhances their creativity, their emotional intelligence, the way that they understand the world around them through their lenses and not through their peers or their parents or their teachers. So encouraging them to know from early age who they are and what they think, what they believe, and all of these constructs that sometimes for us as adults, we realize later in life that everything that we have been thinking for 20, 30, 40 years, it wasn't us. We were just told that. So this is a big mission that I'm really passionate about. And I want to see as many children in schools and at home to be encouraged to write.
You mentioned that sometimes if you're having a conversation with your therapist, you'll reflect on your journal. For me, they seem very complementary. Having a journal, and seeking some kind of, whether it's coaching or therapy to make improvements. Where do you think the ideal combination, how do you have them working synergistically so that, whatever you call it, therapy, personal development, is enhanced by having a journal?
Yes, it's the reflection that happens in between sessions, because of course, during the therapy session, we discuss some very specific situations, emotions. We also use the imagery and I don't remember right now the name of it, but it's a visualization technique that we use as well during the therapy sessions. And of course, after that, there are so many things that come up that you can only cover in a few minutes. And then after that, you have a full week until your next session to actually reflect on all the emotions, everything else that happened, and everything else that felt so so powerful for you, and where it came from, what it means, how you can actually go and look at it. And especially, yes, it's internal family systems. Now I remember the method. And that is a really huge and very deep method, where it brings so many things from childhood that you weren't even aware. So for me, having my journal in between the sessions helps me to make sense of it, because I'm so committed to my inner work, and it's very uncomfortable, and so many times it brings so many emotions, but I want to do it. And I want to be able to untangle all of those things. And when I sit down with my journal, sometimes I write 10 pages, 15 pages, and I sit there and I write until I get everything out from my mind, because it can be a lot. But I think that at the end of that, there is so much relief, so much relief, so much understanding, so much compassion, and so much growth, which is at the end of the day what we're looking for.
Yeah, I think it's growth and development, isn't it? You know, and solving those problems, figuring things out. Not everyone is, let's say, comfortable with writing. You know, maybe they've got negative associations from school and things like that. You know, would you say it's just as beneficial to record thoughts in an auditory way, you know, recording them, or, you know, everyone has camera phones these days, they can kind of get the thoughts out of their head on video? Or is there something unique about turning the thoughts into written words and getting them external?
There are studies that say that when you put pen to paper, there are different connections that happen in your brain, and there are different areas in your brain that light up. And so your visual cortex, your motor cortex, when you start writing, are already there making it happen. And the connections and the links that go on between the information that you're putting in, the input, and already the data that you have from your long-term memory are very different, rather than doing all the other things like typing on your computer or speaking into a recorder. However, I would say that if you don't, you really, really don't want to start keeping a journal, start with those things, like keep writing on even in a Word document, and then save it under a different name, or I don't know, whatever feels safe for you. Or use a voice recorder or a video app. It doesn't matter, as long as you start doing it and you start releasing those thoughts. I'm a big advocate of handwriting, and I'm lucky that science is on my side. But at the same time, I do encourage people that, you know, if you really don't want to do it, instead of doing nothing, it's better to take your phone and do something with it and get rid of that heavy weight and your emotions and everything that you're carrying around.
Is there an ideal frequency? Should it be done? You mentioned like the time, you know, at least 5 minutes or having that consistency, but should we really be doing this daily? Should it be as and when we feel like it's useful? Like, is there an optimum time or frequency to journal?
Ideally, having a habit means to allocate those 5 minutes daily, because it creates that beautiful way of starting your day. For instance, if you do it in the morning and you do the three things that we already mentioned, or even just gratitude and setting the intention, you know, that's enough. And then if you want, you can do the reflection in the evening, and you can maybe take then 2-3 minutes, 5 minutes again. You know, it's really just finding consistency. And if you only do it sometimes, there will not be consistency. Sometimes you may not find the same results. So starting with the smallest techniques, such as gratitude and intention setting, will give you a taste of what it feels like to actually write and keep a journal. And then, you know, maybe once a week at the end of the week on a Sunday, when you have a little bit more time, you can sit down and reflect on something bigger. But if you just think about it, you know, well, I will write when I feel like it, you may not write at all. I do believe that we're all unique and we're all different. And I don't think that there is a set recipe that we can all follow for our personal growth. But there are studies, again, I go back to science, because there are studies that say, just like with meditation, just like with drinking water in the morning, there are different small habits that make a difference. And journaling, again, it doesn't have any side effects. So why not do it and see what happens? And I think there are a few tricks that you can try in order to be able to do it consistently, like keep your journal close to you. For instance, if you want to write in the morning or in the evening, keep it next to your bed. If you want to write before you start reading your emails, keep it on top of your laptop, and you will have it there before you open your laptop. if you feel like you want to go somewhere outside in nature, keep it in your bag all the time, you know, then maybe link it with another habit. There's that concept of habit stacking that, you know, sometimes can be really helpful. And this way you can link it with another thing that you're doing already. Finding something to reward yourself with. I always, when I do workshops with women entrepreneurs, I always share with them that, you know, if you have this habit of putting on hand cream before you go to bed, take a commitment to yourself and say, I'm not going to use my hand lotion until I wrote in my journal. And that's just, you know, something very small that we can use. And these tricks can help us to get that consistency and that frequency of writing on a daily basis.
I think it's really good. I mean, there's clearly lots of distinctions that you've kind of created and identified over the years. If someone wanted to work with you as their coach, so that what it's taken you years and years to kind of figure out all these little different tips and tricks and things that they could get much quicker, what's the best way that they can learn more about you and potentially work with you?
So I'm on all social media, LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook. I also have the podcast, Live Your Impressivity Show. And in the first season is all about journaling. So you can find out more tips about journaling and from different experts in other areas and how journaling connects to that. And obviously on my website, alexbadita.com, that's where I have all the programs that I run and all the coaching and everything else that I do. So, you know, just connecting, I feel that we would definitely find a way to answer your question, or you will find it in some of the resources that I already posted out there, but feel free to reach out and ask away.
I think it's such a powerful thing. And just before we went live, I was saying that, you know, Jim Rohn, a personal development speaker from like the 1980s, I heard a bit of his audio saying, if you do one thing that's going to have a massive impact on your life, start a journal and keep a journal. And, you know, I followed that advice, you know, when I was in my late teens, and it really, really does work. And Alex is the person that can help you get up to speed and make it consistent and get all these benefits of journaling. So Alex, thank you so much for joining me on the show today.
It was a pleasure, Adam. Thank you for having me.
And to you at home, thanks for joining me on Modern Mindset. See you again soon for more.
Thank you for listening to Modern Mindset with Adam Cox. To automatically receive the latest episodes, please subscribe. If you'd like to support the show, please share this episode with just one friend you think it could help. And if this episode helped you, please leave us a 5-star review. Modern Mindset, picking the brains of the world's leading minds to help you unlock yours.